So in order to deliver conservation effectively, we want to make sure we're doing things that work. And a key concept here is that of Kaizen. Kaizen is a Japanese term meaning doing better. And one of the reasons why Toyota and many other Japanese companies are so effective is because they embed Kaizen right the way through the organization. They're continually saying, how could we do this better? And so you can have the same idea in conservation. We could have Kaizen conservation where we're continually saying, what's the best way of doing a particular action? To illustrate this, I'm here with Dr. Ron Summers, who used to be research scientist at the Royal Society for the Protection of Birds. And you brought me to this Scottish pine wood to have a look at this rotting stump. Yeah. Why have you done that?
Okay, right. So deadwood is actually quite an important part of the ecology of all forests. And many animals and plants make use of deadwood. And in particular, we're going to talk about the crested tit, which makes use of dead stumps here as nest sites. So what happens is when the tree dies, over time, the bark sloughs off. As you can see, it's all loose here now. And this is the main part of the timber of the tree here. And it's in two components. There's the sapwood, which is from the outer skin, to the heartwood. The sapwood takes about 10 years or so to rot down. It's now, you can see, it's all quite friable. The fungi have done their work. The heartwood is actually full of resin when the tree was alive, and that was effectively dead. But that's the support that this stump now has. So even when you can rock it, see, like this, it stays still upright. So the crested tits, what they need is a sufficient depth of sapwood to construct their nest chamber. So you see, they can quite easily, they can get through the outer skin of the sapwood, and gradually they go into the heartwood, and then they construct the nest chamber down through this stuff, which is, you can see, it's all breaking away very easily. So what we're interested in doing is, because this is a plantation with a limited number of stumps of a decent size so they can construct the nest site, we thought we could replicate the dimensions of the natural sites in nest boxes. And that was what the project then progressed to.
So although this trunk is too smaller than they actually use, it illustrates the point, and you've worked out what the optimal nest size would be, or possible size would be. What did you do then?
Yeah, so having made measurements of actual real crested tit nest sites, we replicated the dimensions in nest boxes.
And you tested that?
And this is what we're going to show you now.
All right. With help from Isla.
So the study was actually started way back in the 1970s, and the boxes they had available for the study were these very short ones. You can see the distance between the nest entrance and the base of the nest box here is quite small. And that was nowhere near as deep as we find in natural sites where the birds have excavated through sapwood. So what we did was we paired up boxes like this with a new design, which, as you can see, is much deeper and slightly narrower too than the old nest boxes. And what we found was that in this paired experiment, where the birds could make a choice between a small box and a deep one, the tits, blue tits, gold tits, great tits, and crested tits, they all prefer to nest in the deep ones.
Brilliant. So the standard nest design isn't the design that most birds prefer. That's really interesting.
Yes.
So what did you do next?
Well, as I mentioned, the crested tits, they excavate their own nest site in the sapwood of a stump. So we decided to replicate that as well, so that we had, again, in an experiment, we paired up a box like this, which was empty, and a box which was filled with wood shavings and sawdust, so the birds could actually go through the same motions in terms of excavating a nest site. And again, we find that there was a selection, a preference for birds, for boxes where they had to excavate their own chamber. And the advantage of that is that by creating a clean nest chamber each year, there wouldn't be a parasite burden due to overwintering parasites like fleas, which could attack the birds in the following year. Because what happens is that once the breeding season is over and you come back to a nest box the following spring, you'll see fleas all dotted around the nest entrance waiting to jump on an unsuspecting bird. So there is an advantage in going through that extra effort of creating a fresh nest chamber by excavation.
So it's all sorted?
It was sorted up to that point, yes, but then there was another glitch in the story in that, as I said, this study has been going on since the 1970s, and there was a good run of data on how the birds were breeding each year. And they were bumbling along quite happily from year to year. And then in the mid-90s, there was a huge drop in the breeding success, and that continued as very low. We also found that there was dead chicks, bits of dead chicks on the roof of the nest box and also on the ground. So clearly there was a predator operating that hadn't been there before. And we knew too that there was more sightings of pine martens. They'd been restricted to the Northwest Highlands for many years, but gradually they became a protected species. It spread through central and southern Scotland. So we wondered whether the pine martens were now predating the boxes. And sure enough, when we set camera traps close to nest boxes, we got pictures of pine martens. What they do is they push their paws through the nest entrance, and then they were able to scrabble about and pull chicks and adults out of the box, and then they would consume them on the top of the box. We had film of that. So the solution for that, to try and prevent predation, was to fix a metal grid across the nest entrance. And you can see here that the tits have to go through the grid and then to access the box, into the nest box itself. But when martens came, their arms weren't long enough to go through both. So we just had pictures of perplexed pine martens on the top of the boxes, unable to get access to the chicks. And again, the breeding success was back to normal by when that happened. So all these boxes are now fitted with this grid.
So this just seems a fabulous example of how to do conservation, a great example of Kaizen conservation, having a set of problems, thinking through options, which is often done, but then very often that just becomes best practice, and often best practice contains all sorts of things that don't work. But the key element was, in each case, there was a neat test. There was a test of the size of the boxes, of the presence of sawdust, of the predator exclusion device. And each then showed whether or not that action worked. So this seems to me a fabulous example. This is exactly how conservation should be done. And if we did this across conservation, we'd have a better planet.
And more crested tits.
And more crested tits.